Hi there, I'm Andreas Marazis, host of the ANC in Depth. Today we have with us two very distinguished speakers. Right next to me, we have Her Excellency Ambassador of Georgia to the EU, Ms. Natalisa Panadze. And to my far right, Mr. Boris Yaroshevich, Head of Division for Eastern Partnership, Regional Cooperation and OSCE at the European External Action Service. Following up on the event that we organized in the European Parliament earlier today, together with the European Alliance for Georgia, focused on the future of Eastern Partnership, we will try to emphasize during our discussion on the prospects, the challenges, and expectations from the 5th Eastern Partnership Summit, which is scheduled to take place in Brussels in November. So, Natalie, Boris, welcome to ENC in Depth. Natalie, let me start with you first. Being from Georgia, the leading country in terms of reforms and deliverables among Eastern Partnership members, do you believe that the Eastern Partnership framework is still a viable tool for the external promotion of democracy, rule of law, good governance and human rights, as well as conflict management and transborder cooperation?
Thank you for this opportunity. Yes, Eastern Partnership is still very relevant and viable for us from the perspective of Georgia. I have said today in the Parliament that we think it's been a successful initiative for us, especially because it had created the framework that brought us to the signing of the association agreement, and this is a very important tool of modernization, development, but primarily also a manifestation of Georgia's political choice and where we want to go. So Eastern Partnership, I think, still has a lot of potential. I mean, there's been it's been going on for a while, so of course we have certain achievements. This summit is important because it's also the time to evaluate what has been achieved and to look forward and to sort of set out vision for the future. Now, you mentioned external promotion of reforms and so on. I don't think Eastern Partnership is necessarily about imposing certain reforms on us. I think it is very much of a partnership, and it is tailor-made, so it allows for differentiation. Those who want to do more will be able to do more, and those who want different ambitions, different interests, that's also possible to accommodate. Eastern Partnership and in general our relations with the EU, I think there is most advantage and most potential in those countries where the interest in reforms and expectations are domestically driven. This is where it is successful, I think. And we have association agenda, which is very much a kind of a roadmap for these reforms. We do not see it as externally imposed. We do see that there is a lot of harmony because they speak to the domestic reform plan, but mostly there is a lot of interest from civil society, from different political actors. There is real buy-in in this process within the Georgian society, and this is why I think it works. And this kind of combination of domestic interest, expectations, domestic consensus that things need to move as it is seen in this framework, in our case through the association agreement and agenda, and more broadly with others, I think this in that sense is very successful, and we have to try to match this kind of confluence of interests and expectations and ideas in order to make different initiatives work best.
So. Okay. Boris, can I ask for your input on the same question, please?
Yes, as Ambassador Sabah said, I mean, it's a framework which covers bilateral relations between the EU and each of the six partner countries. And also there is a multilateral dimension where we bring the six countries together. It's also extremely an interesting framework because it associates 28 member states, the EU institutions, so we are all around the table. And also it goes beyond the governmental relations because you have civil society, you have parliamentary cooperation, local authorities are cooperating. So I would separate the the battle track, where each of the Eastern partner countries engages in a kind of contractual relation with the EU, which is reciprocal, is mutual in the mutual interest of all parties, of both parties. And there, indeed, I mean, there are a number of requirements that both parties are committed to respect. And in that sense, I think it can contribute to progress in human rights and governance and so on. When it comes to the multilateral dimension, where you have the 28, the 6 around the table, there, of course, it's best suited to tackle cross-border issues in the field of environment, challenges, I don't know, climate change, connectivity, transport. But also this multilateral dimension is very useful to have a kind of peer review by the participants and to exchange best practices, experiences. In that respect, I think that indeed you can contribute to a number of challenges that you have described. When it comes to conflict management, I mean, Eastern Partnership is not really the tool for that. We try in this multilateral dimension to build confidence by the fact that we have the 6 partners together. The member states, I think it helps creating confidence by joint activities, by joint meetings, but it's not a tool to manage conflicts. They are managed under different frameworks with also other actors. But once again, I mean, what is interesting is this combination of bilateral relations, of multilateral dimension, multi-country dimension, and that it covers a broad spectrum of actors, states, NGOs, parliaments, local authorities. And that's, I think, it's a kind of very interesting feature of the Eastern Partnership.
So, we have 6 countries in the Eastern Partnership framework. 3 of them have signed association agreements and the DCFTA. They didn't. Given the fact that Ukraine, Georgia, and Moldova have already been granted visa-free travel and the remaining positive effects will take some time to be materialized, how the EU can support the 3 signatories in terms of, like, in order to keep them on the right track? I know you mentioned that it's not the EU's obligation on keeping the partners on the right track, but how you can assist them? Because the partners ask and you provide. So the same also goes for Georgia. So what do you think are the obligations right now towards the Eastern Partnership and the EU? So Boris, you can...
I think there's a question about motivation. I mean, visa liberalization was a powerful, I think, motivator, because, of course, it's something which matters for the citizens and for the politicians, of course, who have this visa-free regime with Europe. And then it was a strong, powerful driver for reforms, very far-fledged reforms, in Georgia, but also in Moldova and Ukraine. And of course, the question is, what next? I mean, and that I hear very often, particularly indeed from Georgia, Moldova, and Ukraine. You have the association agreement, which is also a very, very deep cooperation agreement or association agreement, which goes very far in terms of political approximation and economic integration. Basically, Georgia, in our case, or Moldova, Ukraine, will become part of the European internal market. And that's at least, I would say, 10 years of work to meet all the benchmarks. So we have roadmaps. I know for Georgia, it's about, I don't know, 300, 400 pieces of legislation that projects have to be approximated and then implemented. So it's a very, very heavy agenda, which I think should be already a motivator by itself because of the benefits that it will bring to society in terms of trade, of course, investments, but in many other areas. So I would say at this stage, but that's my point of view, I think we should focus on the implementation of these agreements, which is extremely heavy for a society, for a public administration. And of course, keep open the possibility to go further, the so-called European aspirations. It's no secret that Georgia has these aspirations. And for us, I mean, these aspirations pass by the full implementation of the association agreement. And then we will probably have to invent something which is short of membership. Because we know that currently in Europe, there is not much appetite for the coming 3 or 4 years for further enlargement or for new candidates. So we'll have to invent something, but always bearing in mind the burden that of the work, rather that it implies for the partner country. Enlargement is adoption of the whole EU acquis, which is 100,000 pages of legislation. It's moving. I mean, it's updating. It's updating regularly, so it's a huge work. So. So I would focus on the full implementation association agreement, the DCFTAs, take full advantage of what it brings, and of course working for the future. And we'll have to invent something, a new formula. I don't have the recipe. As you know, we'll have the Eastern Partnership Summit, which, as you said, the end of November, which will be the opportunity to take stock and also to have a vision for the future. And we'll have to sit around the table. We will start with the member states soon, with the partners in a couple of months. And it's open debate, so we don't know what will be the end result. But definitely, we would like to keep the level of ambitions which was achieved in Haga, where these European aspirations are recognized, European aspirations of Georgia, Republic of Moldova, and Ukraine.
Natalie, you rightly mentioned during the event earlier today that integration is not about only EU membership. It can be economic integration, it can be sectoral dimension integration, and so on and so forth. It was also mentioned today and in other occasions that we also have something more concrete, like the roaming tariff that will be aligned to Georgia and with the EU. So do we have any other tangible, like concrete examples that you can present back home, like visa freezing, for example?
Well, visa was a peculiar case, I think, and it will be difficult to replicate quite something like this because, you know, it was a benefit that everybody very easily understood. It was for all citizens, and it really worked well, as Boris mentioned, because it had a clear goal. It had a clearly defined conditionality roadmap how to achieve it, and we, of course, benefited a lot from the experience and expertise of European experts in this process, and as a result we feel that now we are a reliable partner of the EU in the times of difficulties, including in this migration crisis, you know, this is a mutually beneficial outcome, and of course this has given our citizens the opportunity to enjoy short-term travel, and something that really also symbolically was very important. So to replicate something quite like this, which is so doesn't require much explanation and is easily understood by everyone, might be difficult. But nevertheless, I do want to go back to that point that, yes, we do speak about integration mainly defined in terms of membership, non-membership, and the fact that we want membership is not a secret, and you know, everybody knows it by now, but we also know that this is a highly highly conditional wish. The EU should also want the same, and we should be ready for it. And these two conditions are not being met at the moment. So this does not mean that we should stop now and say, okay, well, it's not happening, so let's forget about it. Absolutely not. And that is precisely the wish to sort of try to look for new benchmarks, similar to VLAB, perhaps identify a sector where you can really have a clear goal with a plan that can actually deliver and that's sellable. And we do look at the, you know, we look at transport, we look at infrastructure. This infrastructure is big. It's something that that's really tangible. People will feel it. And it's important strategically for a country like Georgia, which is literally on the crossroads, to be able to take advantage of its location and to you know, to position itself as a hub, as a transport corridor, and so on. So this is, and be connected with European networks. That's also a way of integration. Economic integration that Boris mentioned for the DCFTA to fully work, it will of course take time. But the ultimate goal is economic integration of Georgia into the European market, the full integration. There are other areas, for example, in education, which I think is fundamental, and we now are part of these programs to work more on how to exchange knowledge, how to become more connected. My generation has benefited enormously from the little exchanges that were taking place between students at the time of the collapse of Soviet Union. That was mainly coming from Washington, actually. They had a clear program with scholarships, and the entire government is run by alumni of these programs. This you cannot measure the extent of impact this has had on a small country like Georgia. And now that we are such close partners with the EU, I think this really should be a priority. And education is an area, again, where everybody feels it. Everyone is a parent, you know, you feel strongly about the future, the knowledge, the development, and this will trickle down also developing society in a more sort of multidimensional way, not only having one sector like agriculture or sort of traditional sectors, but actually developing knowledge-based economy, taking advantage of old schools, traditions that we have, and building on the new expertise and so on. So there are definitely areas, and we have to define integration broadly, not limiting it only to membership, and we do need this positive message also from the EU, saying that you can move ahead, you know, with integration in different spheres.
Okay, thank you. I will now move to a hot topic, which is about propaganda and how to counter it. So one of the main issues to be addressed during the Eastern Partnership Summit is how to strengthen resilience against propaganda, not only resilience of our partners, but also our resilience back home in the EU. Also, we witnessed that in the EU-NATO joint declaration in July 2016, there was a strong emphasis on countering disinformation. So I would like to ask you, Boris, is the current mechanism, basically the East Stratcom that was established in 2015, sufficient or more needs to be done? I'm also aware that there are projects that were funded by individual member states, like I'm recalling a case where UK was funding a project in Ukraine called Stop Fake. So do we have similar funding opportunities for organizations on the ground for such projects, or what other mechanisms do we have so as to counter propaganda?
Well, it's an issue. We are very aware of it. Probably you never do enough, so of course you could do more. I think what is extremely important is to have the partner countries on board, particularly the three associated countries, Georgia, Moldova, and Ukraine, which are the most interested. And that's why, I mean, basically, we try to develop together to fit into the strategies which are developed by those countries, because they know the ground much better than we do, and they know the environment and the context. So we will step up these campaigns ahead of the summit, the recent partnership summit, but relying on a lot on national forces in the partner countries. Because I think if we are in Georgia, I think nobody better than a Georgian can explain to another Georgian what is about, what is the EU, what is it about, and the success stories. I mean, you don't need necessarily to bring foreign experts to present that. So that's why we have programs, different programs, European Commission, the External Action Service, and we combine these efforts with what is done by the national government. The problem that first it's a general debate which is happening also in our country, so it shows that the Eastern parties are also part of the global questions, and of course there is a specific case of Russia and so on, but there is a global debate around the world about fake news and so on, so it's part of a global trend. And second, the question, I mean, we try to present facts, to be factual, but to me it's not enough, because this information is about emotions, basically. Mm-hmm. That is extremely difficult. Even if you come with facts, black and white, doesn't mean that people will believe you, because they've heard something and presented in a different way with emotion involved. That's what propaganda is about. I mean, so it's quite difficult, but we try to be factual, to present objective picture of what the EU is doing in the Eastern partner countries, what we are bringing, to rely on very concrete stories told by people, ordinary people, let's say, not officials or experts. And we are building a narrative on that. But of course, it's never enough. And we rely also a lot on the member states. As you know, ahead of the summit, I mean, there is a lot of thinking about the Eastern Partnership. A number of member states have produced non-papers, including on strategic communication, which ideas that we are now analyzing in order to implement it. So my point is, of course, we will do a lot, we will combine forces, but it's not only about money, it's not only about be factual, it's also something about emotions, about hearts, about feelings, and that's extremely difficult. That's more for propagandists, and we don't want to do propaganda, of course. But you see, I mean, even tell the truth, or what you see the truth, or at least when you tell facts, doesn't mean that people will believe you. And that's difficult. What we try also, particularly in Georgia, is also together with the authorities, is to reach the minorities, which are a little bit cut from the mainstream information flow and are more oriented towards other sources. And that's why we try to produce our materials in different languages, including in Russian, actually, but so that everybody can have access to these facts and factual information.
Can I ask Natalie to provide some examples of what kind of activities are taking place towards strengthening resilience against propaganda in Georgia, and how you cooperate from your side with the European Union this topic?
Firstly, I should probably say that perhaps we former Soviet countries have natural resilience towards propaganda a bit more than European states, because it hasn't been that long that we remember the entire sort of media space being a propaganda. So there are some skills there in the public that can decipher where where things lie. But still, of course, this is a different type, and it exists also in Georgia. A kind of natural counterweight to this is that in Georgia there is an emotional Euro enthusiasm, and that helps. That is also emotional, perhaps more than it is rational. So, again, perhaps that's another factor why propaganda is not so effective in Georgia, I would say. And that doesn't mean that it is not working. And it's working precisely with the aim of undermining the kind of societal consensus that there is in Georgia about the future of the country and about its European and Euro-Atlantic integration, because they try to question this path. They invoke costs that are attached to it, you know, the territorial integrity, the economic costs, and so on. But nevertheless, the consensus is still very strong, and after visa liberalization, we see that the polls show even greater support for European integration. It's very high, it's in the 80s. So it's there. So we have a combination of factors, as I said, the sort of past legacy of communist propaganda and Euro enthusiasm now, that is a natural counterweight to what is going on. At the same time, of course, government has programs, and there are departments set kind of fist stratcom style that look at the propaganda material, that look at the, this is not so much propaganda, even these are lies that are being spread through various sources. So we try to identify them, we try to come up with different myth boosting strategies through internet publications, through communication directly with people, particularly in minority areas that are most vulnerable for this, because you know, they, because of the language barrier and so on, they are more they have more of influence from other sources. So this is happening through direct communication, through media. Civil society is very much mobilized. There are various studies that are being published, even at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. You have a unit that looks at it. And we cooperate very closely with this Stratcom, feed some information, they get information from us, they come to Georgia. So I think in that sense, it's effective. In our case, it probably is effective. But, you know, how to do it better, it's a difficult one. And I completely agree with Boris, because it's not only about calling a spade a spade. It's, you know, in our post-truth world, there are other factors that are also playing a role, and I think it's also important that the propaganda and these kind of messages, poisoned messages, to be honest, are stopped within EU member states too, because maybe they are even more powerful here than in other countries.
Okay. Still, if I can, I mean, because even with the Soviet past, I'm surprised how people are
still buying,
because in the Soviet time nobody was believing TV and so on, but now everybody believes. I mean, in Russia everybody believes, 90% believe state TVs. In Georgia also some private channels are also taken, I mean, whatever they say is taken as granted. So I'm still surprised that people do not analyze news like they did in the Soviet time, but that's just a remark. You know better. So there is still a trust in TV, particularly. In TV.
Okay. Moving from the issue of propaganda to EU policy that some say that has been forgotten. I'm referring to the 2009 non-recognition and engagement policy towards Abkhazia and South Ossetia, that focuses on the isolation. So do you think that this policy is still valid? And if yes, how much political will exist in Georgia right now so as to endorse these or similar initiatives?
We haven't forgotten about this policy.
Mm-hmm.
of course, the situation in the occupied regions is the top priority for us. It is the major national security interest, so it's difficult to forget about it. This policy is still very much alive, and it is a kind of a, I wouldn't even call it a specific policy. It's more rather a framework within which we operate. It has non-recognition part on the one side, and that is extremely important for us because what is going on is illegal under international law, and we should maintain this as such. It's a principled position, and a lot of our diplomatic resource is being spent on this so that it stays like this. And at the same time, under this principled position, there is a flexibility that we should try and engage a bit more. Now, it's of course easier said than done. It is very complicated. We have a situation that we have growing, you can say gradual annexation of these regions with the signing of the integration treaties, with the ongoing so-called borderization, which further isolates these regions from the rest of Georgia and isolates it from the rest of the world. It is extremely worrisome to see what is going on. And our room for maneuver is increasingly limited as a result of these steps. Even when it comes to physical movement, this is essential for any engagement. There should be, the trend should be towards easing of physical connections between people. But the opposite is happening. I've mentioned the barbed wires that separate Georgia, particularly in the Tsin Valley region. There's been ongoing closure of checkpoints in Abkhazia that has a big impact on the local population, increases the likelihood of incidents and so on, and contributes to the deterioration of the situation that is then reflected in the Geneva international discussions and so on. So it's not a very positive dynamic, unfortunately, but nevertheless, we do try to find ways out. I mean, we do want to create some confidence building measures. There is a lot of investment going on in the regions adjacent to the administrative borderline, providing healthcare services free of charge for all residents of the occupied regions in Georgia, irrespective of their ethnicity, of course. These steps are important. There's been an exchange, for example, from the Georgian side. We have handed over archive materials to Abkhazia, and that was a sign of goodwill. So there are small tangible steps that can be made within this framework, and I also believe that there is a potential for making them much bigger. Had the side of the conflict, which it doesn't admit to be the side, Russia has sort of allowed for this to happen. I think a lot of the space is blocked by Russia and its position, and that's a reality.
Boris, do you think that we can export and apply this policy in other cases in the Eastern Partnership countries, for example, Transnistria, or in any other case?
No, I think it's the other way around. I mean, Transnistria is more advanced in terms of relations because the association agreement, the DCFTA with the Republic of Moldova, are applicable to Transnistria, the economic contacts. So that's, I would say, the rather a good example that we should try and apply in Georgia, which is extremely difficult. I mean, our policy remains valid. I mean, it's a matter of principle, non-recognition of what happened in 2008 and this change by force of the borders of Georgia, attempt to the territorial integrity of Georgia. But we also try to engage, not to de-isolate, because this territory, they are isolating themselves. I mean, it's not our role to de-isolate them. What we try to do is to engage on a number of, again, common issue of common interest. Not only us, but also the UN agencies. I mean, we have a program there in the field of health, in the field of agriculture. Of course, never working with authorities, but rather with people or private companies. So the this policy, I think, is still valid. The association agreement with Georgia, in principle, in theory, covers and is applicable to these territories as well. We know it's not possible today. And I understand it's extremely difficult for Georgia because you don't have a response on the other side. On the contrary, I mean, it's closing itself. Crossing points numbers are reducing. I mean, there are a lot of obstacles to movement, to education in Georgia, which is disgraceful. And I understand it's extremely difficult for Georgia to do something. And a lot of efforts are done. It's a long-term process, I think, but the leverage of, I think, rule of law in Georgia, of economic development, which will come with the DCFT, mobility, I think may have an impact in the longer term. Particularly Abkhazia, who is, let's say, not very keen to become part of Russia. South Ossetia is a bit different issue because there is nobody there, and it's basically a military base now, which is a serious security threat for Georgia. But Abkhazia, I think we may, at some point, we may, if there are some also changes, I guess, in Russia, we may expand the benefits of the DCFT and so on to this territory. But I think the framework is still valid, but there is definitely a lack of will and of goodwill on the side of one big actor there.
Well, with that, at this point, I would like to conclude our discussion by thanking both of you for being here and for your valuable, interesting contributions. I'm Andreas Marazis, and that was the ENC In Depth.